Good evening, everyone. A very warm welcome to all the participants. I'm Deepak Sahu, head of the Department Geology, KJ Somaiya College of Science and Commerce, Mumbai. This is our third public lecture in this month, and our objective of this public lecture is to share the current research which is going in geoscience field. I won't take much time. Today's topic is monogenetic volcanoes, or its origin, evolution, and their control in local paleo and environment condition. For this, I welcome our speaker, who is our own alumni. She is Dr. Pooja Shirsagar. A brief introduction about Pooja is she has completed her bachelor's from our department, KJ Somaiya College of Science and Commerce, affiliated to Mumbai University. She has done her master's from MS University of Baroda, and then she did her PhD in volcanology from IIT Bombay, and then she has two postdoc as well, one from UNAM Geophysica, and the second is from CICESE, Baja, California. She is currently working as professor investigator in University of Guanajuato, Mexico. This is a brief introduction about Pooja, and I won't take much time in introducing this public lecture, and I will head over to Pooja. Hi Pooja, are you available? You're online?
Hi Deepak, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay.
Loud and clear.
Okay.
So how are you doing?
I'm good. How are you doing?
I'm also good. One more thing I want to say for this lecture, Pooja is still in Mexico, and she is alive from Mexico, and it's early morning in Mexico, and we are troubling her for this lecture. Very sorry for that.
No, it's okay. I wake up at this hour, so not a problem.
Okay. So you can continue, Pooja.
Sure. Thanks. So a very good evening to everybody, my fellow Indians back in my country. I hope everything is going well with you people. And just to make your day a little bit interesting, well, let's talk about volcanoes. So today I'll be discussing about one of the theme that I investigate here in Mexico, which are monogenetic volcanoes. I'll explain what are monogenetic volcanoes, how they form, their evolution, and how we can use these volcanoes to determine the paleo environment conditions. So basically, this is going to be the talk for today. Of course, you can see in the screen that there is an email address. If any student have any inquiries regarding this kind of investigation, you feel free to just send me an email, and I may get back in touch with you and hope to help you people. Okay, so without much ado, let's go ahead. So let's talk about volcanoes. I'm not sure whether everybody knows what is a volcano, its components and its products. So let's begin with the basics, and I'll just go over the basics like within like few seconds. So here it is. Here you can see that on the left hand side, you can see that there is a typical diagram or a sketch of a volcano or a section of a volcano, where you can see that there are different components of volcanoes. And apart from that, you can see different products of volcanoes. And based on the components and products, there are different types of volcanoes, different types of eruptions and different types of morphologies or different types of volcanic cones. In general, when you say that, oh, this mountain is a volcano, you always typically see a cone-shaped structure. And this cone-shaped structure is formed due to the accumulation of different type of products of volcanoes. As you can see, first let's talk about the components. So the components are, a volcano always forms due to the presence of magma. What is a magma? A magma is a multi-component substance where you have melted rock, you also have minerals of high temperature, and then you have some volatiles or gases in the form of carbon dioxide or sulfur dioxide, etc. Now these magma can have different composition. It can be acidic or basic. And so we can call it as a magma rhyolitic in composition or basaltic in composition. And the more acidic the magma is, the more explosive the eruption would be if it has high volatile content. But if the magma is acidic in composition and has low volatile content, it will just form domes, okay? So depending upon the composition and the volatile content, we might get different products. So how does this magma come from? Come onto the surface, magma is a conduit. So here you can see that there is a vertical conduit. Now this conduit can have several subconduits or several passages. So all this depends on the tectonic configuration of that area. So once the magma comes onto the surface, it's like when you agitate a bottle of Coca-Cola and you open the tap, what happens? All the gases, all the water dies, just erupts. And when it erupts, it forms eruptive columns. So here you can see, this is an eruptive cloud, which is formed due to the eruptive column. This structure, we also called it as mushroom cloud, because it has a mushroom-like shape. And depending on the direction of the wind, the cloud will migrate. And once the cloud loses its energy, it will start depositing material due to gravity. Okay, so when you have a eruptive cloud, you can see that there are ashes, fine ashes. When I say ash, these are materials or particles which have less than 63 micron size. So these can stay in the environment for some time, and then due to gravity, they fall onto the surface. And when they fall onto the surface, they form ash falls. Sometimes what happens is that these particulates or these ash particles, they combine with the clouds which get rains, and then they react with these clouds, and they form acid, like acid rain. But when I say acid rain, obviously it's not that like acidic in nature. But yes, when you stay near volcanoes, you are most likely to get ash falls and acid rains. So this is one of the product that we get from a volcano. The next thing is that we have lava flows. When the magma, which is coming onto the surface, does not have enough volatiles, then it just flows. It comes onto the surface and it just pours out. It's just like when you unbottle or uncork a bottle of champagne which doesn't have fizz anymore, it just pours out. Okay, it doesn't have any explosivity. So it will form lava flows. Now there are two types of lavas, Pa Hoi Hoi and A'a. I won't go much into detail because there are many other types of lavas as well. But depend upon the composition, we have different types of lava flows. Now, this is the second product. The third product that we get is pyroclastic flows. Then you have lahares. Then you have debris avalanche or landslides. And then you have fumaroles or gases or geothermal events near the volcano. So these are the products. Another product is a dome, a lava dome. So when do we get lava dome? When the magma is very much viscous, It is acidic in nature, very much viscous, does not have much volatiles. So it will just come out onto the surface, and because it has high resistance, it won't flow that easily. So it will form domes. So these are the different products that we get from a volcano. And the most important product that we get from an explosive volcano are volcanic bombs. So it is very interesting when you're walking around a huge volcano, stratovolcano, and it's an eruption, and you have to take care about the volcanic bombs if you're pretty close to the bombs, to the crater. So this is the basic, like this is how we picture a volcano. But when you do investigation, you can see that not every volcano is same, and it is not so simple, because volcanoes simple like this is very difficult to find. Okay, so say always what we have seen, or in my experience, what I have come across, the volcanoes, they have very complex system. So based on the complexity, how we can resolve this complexity? So in order to resolve this complexity, we need to understand what kind of eruptions took place. What was the intensity of the eruptions? What kind of magma came out of the volcano? And what kind of structure the volcano has? So when I say that there are different types of eruptions, here you can see in this figure, depending on the height of the eruption column, when I say eruption column, it is this part, okay? So depending on the eruption columns, you can see that there are different types of eruptions. So for example, if I have a volcano, I'm studying a volcano and it had an eruption, and the eruption cloud has, or the eruption cloud has a height of more than 30 kilometers or more than 55 kilometers, I can classify this kind of volcanoes as subplinian or ultraplinian. But eruption, not the volcano, okay? So each volcano is different, and different types of eruptions are associated to each volcano. So it is quite common that a volcano can have all these different types of eruptions. So how do I come to know about this type of eruptions? I study the deposits. I study the products that come out of the volcano. Apart from that, whenever you have eruptions of high intensity, it actually has the tendency to change the morphology of a volcano. So I can get different types of volcanoes. You can see here, if I say that I have a stratovolcano, when I say a stratovolcano, automatically what comes to my mind is that the volcano is built up of lava flows and ash particles. Okay. Apart from that, when I say if a volcano is a compound complex, then I can say that there are two vents or two structures that are like one that are overlapping on each other. Sometimes you have a caldera-like morphology, and within the caldera you might get a dome. And sometimes you just have shield volcanoes, which are like the most quietest volcanoes and the most gigantic volcanoes that we have on our planet. Okay. Now, based on the eruption, we have the intensity. And like for earthquakes, we have Richter scale. We have volcano index, volcano explosivity index to determine the intensity of the eruption. Okay, so here you can see that there are different scales which classify different type of different intensities of eruptions. So the smallest is the Larsen Peak from California, and you can see the amount or the volume of materials or products that comes out of a volcano. And the greatest or the most explosive is the Toba eruption that took place around 74,000 years ago in Indonesia, and the amount or the volume of material that came out from this volcano. Let me just give you an idea that the Toba eruption, which took place 74,000 years ago in Indonesia, its ashes traveled up to India. So in India, we do have the deposits of Toba eruptions. So you can imagine the scale of eruption. So we have the volcano explosivity index from 1 to 7. Okay, Also, based on the composition of magma or lava, you can see that there are different types of volcanoes, or the morphology or different morphologies of volcanoes that can form. So shield volcanoes are mostly associated with magmas like basaltic in composition because they are very fluid. Then you have the cinder cones or scoria cones. Then you have the composite volcanoes, which where you have two stratovolcanoes, one overlapping another. And then you have dome complexes when you have magmas or lavas, which are more silicic or acidic in composition and more resistant. Okay, so this is a basic terminology or basic things that we need to know about a volcano before we jump to monogenetic volcanoes. Now, let me tell you that monogenetic volcanoes are just like bonsais of volcanoes because they are like small versions of a volcano. So let's go ahead. How we can classify between monogenetic and polygenetic volcanoes? So what we saw till now was a description for a polygenetic volcano. A polygenetic volcano can be of any size, any dimension, okay? But it should have multiple eruptions. Now, how we come to know about the multiple eruptions? It should, when you see the deposits, the products coming out of this eruption, they should have enough time period. Like I should have deposits, if the volcano formed in the late Pleistocene time, then I should have eruption right from late Pleistocene until today. And every eruption has to be separated by some marker bed. It could be paleosol, it could be erosion surface or vegetation. So there has to be some separation between each eruption. But if a volcano is very active and it has an eruption continuously, then it becomes very difficult to differentiate between this eruptive beds or different products. So what we do, we date the pumice, we date the juvenile fragments or the magma, the minerals that are coming out of this volcano, and we try to date different episodes of eruption. So a polygenetic volcano has multiple eruptions, multiple episodes of eruptions. Now, a simple polygenetic volcano would be that we have one magma chamber, one conduit, and we have multiple eruptions coming out from the same conduit. But it is not the case because every volcano is different, and the local tectonic configuration plays a very important role in forming the plumbing system of a volcano. So what we generally find are the compound polygenetic volcanoes. What are compound polygenetic volcanoes? You might have a shallow magma chamber. You might have one magma chamber or multiple magma chambers. And these magma chambers may have multiple conduits. Now, each of these conduits may form a different set of volcano, but they are so close to each other that they form a cluster, a compound. So that's why you call them as compound polygenetic volcanoes. Now, similar case can be found in monogenetic volcanoes. When I say monogenetic, there is only one episode of eruption. This is the difference between mono and polygenetic volcanoes. In poly, you have multiple eruptions. In mono, you just have one episode of eruptions. Okay, so there is just one activity. This activity can be from hours, from days, and can last up to few months or few years. But once the magma chamber has been vacated, then you have no activity. So you just form a single small volume volcano, which are monogenetic volcanoes. So let's see different types of monogenetic volcanoes. It has been seen always that monogenetic volcanoes are associated to magmas coming from deep source. Okay. So if this magma is coming from different conduits and these conduits are very close to each other, what do we get on the surface is a cluster. So each conduit will have one episode of eruption. It will form a small volcano. Then there will be another conduit that will form another volcano, and such they will form a cluster. Now, most of the time, these clusters, they do have alignment, and the alignment is quite similar to the regional tectonic trends. If there is a fault, if there is a fissure, okay? Sometimes you also get a large volume monogenetic volcanoes, which in case of Mexico, it's quite common. This is because of ample quantity of magma, okay? Apart from that, you have polymagmatic compound monogenetic volcanoes. Here, what happened is you just have one vent or one structure, and you have multiple conduits. Now, these conduits might have multiple magma chamber and may have magma from different compositions. So, everything okay? Okay. So, the structure which has been formed is just one simple volcano. But when you study the deposits or the product that is coming out of the volcano, it may have different composition. That's why we say it polymagmatic compound monogenetic volcano. Then you have a polymagmatic simple monogenetic volcano where you have one conduit, but this one conduit is associated with different magma chambers and may have different magma composition. These magma, it comes onto the surface and pours out and forms a single structure. But when you study the deposits, it has different composition. So this is a polymagmatic simple monogenetic volcanoes. And a monogenetic volcano sensu stricto is a volcano which forms through one conduit, one magma chamber, and one structure. It is quite difficult to find something like this, as most of the monogenetic volcanoes that I have worked so far are polymagmatic, or either they are polymagmatic simple compound, or they are in the form of clusters. So now we have a basic idea about how to classify a monogenetic and a polygenetic volcano. So let's go ahead. How do they look? How do they form? Now, when I say this monogenetic volcanoes, they always occur in form of clusters or groups. And that's why they form a volcanic field. And when you study a volcanic field, you can see that there are different types of morphologies or different types of structures or edifice, volcanic edifice that are formed. You can see here. And how are these volcanic edifices formed? Well, the most common monogenetic volcanoes are scoria cones. Here you can see a photo, a very good picture of Paricutín, which is the most active, which was the most active volcano in Mexico. I'll explain about this volcano later. Then you have something called as tuff rings. Here you have one example, El Caracol. And then you have Mar volcanoes. I'll explain to you how these volcanoes form. Here you can see something very interesting. It is like a crater. It is not forming a positive structure. It is forming a negative structure, or more or less like an inverted funnel structure. So how does this type of volcano comes into picture? And then you have a tuff cone, Alberca de los Espinos. So these are the typical monogenetic volcanoes which you will encounter in a volcanic field, monogenetic volcanic field. Let's see how they form. Now, the ingredients that we need for the formation of these type of volcanoes is magma and water. Here you can see a very simplified explanation about for the formation of different types of monogenetic volcanoes. Here you can see that we have a increasing ratio of water and magma, which means that the amount of magma increases downward. And here you can see the amount of mechanical energy. When I say mechanical energy, I'm talking about the energy created when the water interacts with magma. Now, I'm not sure many of you must have seen in your house, when you're trying to cook something, you put oil and the oil is very hot. And you and if by mistake you put some water in it, what happens? Fragmentation. Okay, mechanical fragmentation. The same thing happens with water and magma. So when you have an external water source and this water source comes in contact with the magma, which is ascending onto the surface, what happens? Explosion, fragmentation. Okay, when it interacts and fragments, it forms different type of monogenetic volcanoes. Now, when there is little or no water, what we get is a cinder cone, which is something like this, a scoria cone. Here you can say very little water or there was absolutely no water involved. So what happened? The magma came onto the surface. It had a Strombolian eruption. And when you have a Strombolian eruption, what are the products that you get? Most of the time you get lava flows and scoria particles. So that's why you call this type of cones as scoria cones or cinder cones. But when you increase the quantity of the participation of water, what we get is a tuff ring. Here is an example. Here you can see that this is a crater. And on the margins, you can see that there are some deposits. How are these deposits formed? These deposits are nothing but the material that has been fragmented due to the interaction of water and magma. When you increase the interaction, when you increase the quantity of water, what you get is tuff cones. So what happens now? As you keep on increasing the quantity of water, the magma fragments more and the surrounding lithology or the country rock also fragments. So you have more material that is coming out onto the surface. So it forms a small cone with a crater within. And this crater, most of the time, has water inside because of the water table. If you have a very shallow water table, then you might have a lake inside. But you can see that it had formed a cone because there was large amount of interaction between of water and magma. And there was large amount of fragmentation. The extreme part or the extreme scenario is when you have a water magma interaction to a ratio of 0.2, when you have that interaction, you will get a volcano which is negative, which has a negative profile. Instead of forming a positive cone, like these cones, you will get a volcano which is like an inverted funnel. And of course, these craters always have lakes or they have precipitates within. I'll show you some pictures of that too. So what do we have here? Here is a section of a Mar. When I say it's a Mar volcano, what we can see that it has a crater. The crater has a lake within. Also, it has sediments. And on the margin of the crater, you have deposits, which is called as the ejecta ring. So here you can see this part, you will have an ejecta or the tephra deposits. Now to understand the evolution of these volcanoes, I have to study the deposits that are coming out of this volcano or the products that is coming out of this volcano. When you make a geophysical study, you will see that exactly below the crater, you will find a very randomly distributed complex structure, which is called as the diatreme. Okay. Now this diatreme is nothing but the region where the interaction of water and magma takes place. Now, when I say that water and magma interacts, we need to know that where this water comes from. Now, sometimes these types of volcanoes can form in region where at the margin of a lake, where you have water available on the surface or along a river, major river. It can form in delta zones, or it can form in the zone near the lake, near the ocean, near beaches, as you see in Hawaii, or it can form inland where you have a very rich groundwater system. So let's go ahead. Okay, So what are the factors that are responsible for the formation of this kind of volcanoes? Now the factors are divided into two: internal factors and external factors. In my experience, I have seen that the internal factor does not play an important role, as this is because even if you have a magma of basaltic composition or rhyolitic composition, it doesn't matter. What matters is the external factor or the external conditions. What are the parameters in external conditions that we take into consideration? It's the regional tectonics, the topography, the substrate configuration. When I say the substrate configuration, I mean that where the eruption is taking place. It is taking place in a hard rock substrate, or whether it is taking place in a soft rock substrate or an unconsolidated sediment. Also, the availability of external water in the form of groundwaters or aquifers. It also depends on the type of aquifers. Now, sometimes what happens is these volcanoes, they begin to form, and suddenly it used all the water that was available. So what happens? The volcano, instead of becoming a mar, now becomes a scoria cones. Okay, so what I'm trying to say is that all these external factors actually controls the phreatomagmatism. When I say the word phreatomagmatism, phreato is phreatic or water, and magmatic, it explains about the interaction between water and magma. So once you run out of water, a phreatomagmatic eruption will turn into magmatic. And when a phreatomagmatic eruption turns into magmatic, a mar diatreme volcano can turn into a scoria cone, can turn into a scoria cone or a spatter cone. But during its transition, you might get different complex depending on the combination of how much quantity of water and magma was available. Okay, so when I say that these are like bonsais of volcanoes and they are small, it doesn't mean that they're very easy to interpret, because these volcanoes often are quite complex, and depending on the water magma interaction, you might get a complex system where you find that the volcano actually began as a mar diatreme, but it actually end up as a scoria cone because there was no sufficient water. Or it might be reverse, that it began with a spatter cone or scoria cone and then it turned into a mar diatreme. So how you understand, how you study the evolution of these types of volcanoes, we have to look for the deposits. Now, before coming on to the deposits, I would like to discuss something about the morphology of this type of volcanoes. You can see here the schematic diagrams taken from Nimitz and Keresuri suggest that how this volcano has a morphology. No, like for example, if this interaction of water and magma takes place in a hard rock substrate, when I'm saying hard rock substrate, I include limestones, I include metamorphic rocks, I include igneous rocks, which are compact. Okay, so when the interaction takes place in hard rock substrate, we often find a crater which has a very steep slope, as you can see here. This is an example. Here you can see the crater. Initially it had water in it, but now you just find precipitates, because in this region they have the water table level has been reduced drastically. But here you can see the morphology, that it has very steep crater walls. This indicates that the volcano, it formed in a hard rock substrate. But when a volcano forms in a soft rock substrate, it doesn't have a very steep crater wall. It is more or less like a bowl shape. Okay. Another aspect that I would like to highlight is mostly the crater lake that we have is full of algae. And sometimes these algae, due to the change in tectonic configuration, they might change their color. So they form red color. They give like reddish color to the water. And it is believed here in Mexico by the people who live near this kind of craters that whenever the crater changes its color to red, it indicates that there is going to be an earthquake. Something similar was recently found in Lonar. I'm not saying that Lonar Lake is a Mar volcano. Lonar Lake, it has been established that it is formed due to meteorite impact. But something similar has been found in the Lonar Lake in Maharashtra is the change in color. I'm not sure how many of you have come across this article, but I'm damn sure that the change in the color is because of the algae that sensed some change in the activity. Now we have to look for the reason that triggered this kind of change. So how does in general this kind of volcanoes look when I say a monogenetic volcanic field? Now here I'm presenting a picture of Michoacán, Guanajuato volcanic field. This picture I have taken on top of a stratovolcano, which is Paracho. It is somewhere around 3000 something meters above sea level. And from the top, what you can see? You can see massive monogenetic volcanoes, which are in the form of shield. And then you can see the scoria cones. And you can see how close they are. So the density of these shields and density of the scoria cones, it's very high in this region, in Michoacán, Guanajuato volcanic field. And these are forming clusters. And when these form clusters, they give rise to a very complex volcanic field. Now let's understand how these volcanoes come into formation. To understand this, we need to study the products that are coming out of the volcano. So what are the products? Let me first show you a video where you can see the style of eruption that is responsible for the formation of these kind of volcanoes. Then we will talk about different types of deposits and I'll show you some examples. Okay, so let's see this video. Let me explain you. Here you can see there is a volcano that is forming within the ocean. So what you can see? You can see there is a lot of steam vapor coming out of the volcano and you can see here hawk's tail like jet. You can see the explosion. You call this like a cock's tail. And in the same time, you can see that there is surges, ground surges, that is moving radially from the center of the eruption. So what happens? Whenever there is an interaction between water and magma, we get this kind of eruptions, okay? And when we get this kind of eruption, we get three different types of deposits. These deposits, we call them as pyroclastic deposits. Pyro means fire, clastic means clast. So these pyroclastic deposits can be differentiated into three types. It can be differentiated as pyroclastic fall, flow, and surges. How do you differentiate this on field? On field, they should have this kind of appearance. A pyroclastic fall always, like you have material which is going onto the atmosphere and it will just fall onto the surface due to gravity. So they are like free falling material. And definitely due to gravity, the material or the clast which are heavy, they will fall first. And the one which are smaller and lighter, they will fall later. So what do you get? You get a normal graded clast. So here you can see in this photo, the dark beds or units are actually pyroclastic fall. What are the terminology that we usually use in on field? Here overall, you call this as a tephra sequence or a tephra package. And each package, then you divide in different units. And each unit is later divided into different beds. Okay, so here you can see that there is a tephra fall unit. Below this, you can find the gray thing is a surge. You can see the surge usually have does not have like a mantling like appearance. And then you have flow. Here, I cannot find any flow, but I will show you in next pictures. So what I see here in a Tefra package is the eruption. It began with surges, then it became a fall, and then it became a flow. Okay. So this is how you differentiate on field. Now, the most difficult type of pyroclastic deposit to determine or to identify on field are the pyroclastic flows and surges, because it becomes difficult to differentiate between them. So here we go. Here is a classification given by Moorhouse and White in 2016, where you have different types of appearance or different type of stratigraphy along the flow directions, and you can use different type of classifications. I won't go much into details over here, but I'll show you some pictures over here which can explain very well. It's somewhat like sedimentary beds, cross stratifications, dune-like morphologies, okay? Also, you can see that there are different sizes. For example, when you have surges are mostly associated with fine ash particles. But when you see flows might have fine ash particles as well as coarse clast. So here you can see that there are these fine ash surges. Also, you have coarse particle or coarse lapilli flow, pyroclastic flow units. Apart from that, the most interesting features that you can find in a pyroclastic flow or surge are impact sacs. Here you can see this kind of feature or this kind of observation, or how you can say, oh, feature. This kind of feature is called as an impact sac. These are usually formed when you're having an eruption, there is a base surge, okay? Just try to remember the video I showed you. You are having an eruption, and then you saw that there was like a cocktail like in jet eruption, which had blocks in it. Now, when these blocks due to gravity falls onto the surface, they form a sag. Okay, so these are like bombs that is falling onto the base surges, and they form impact sags. Now, depending on the distance, for example, when you're closer to the vent or closer to the mouth of the volcano, you will find huge impact sacs because you have huge bombs. But when you go far away from the mouth of the volcano or the center of the volcano, you will have small impact sacs. So what do we do on field? Here you can see a very good example where you can see the transition from magmatic to phreatomagmatic, as in from fall to flow to surges. So what we do, we go on field, we try to take samples from each unit. Initially, we try to determine the stratigraphy of the region. So we produce a sketch Then we mark the units that we sampled, and then we perform granulometry analysis. In granulometry analysis, we take into consideration the size fractions from 6 feet to 4 feet. Okay, and these granulometry analysis we do by hand because the fragments that are involved or the clasts that are involved, they're very fragile. So we don't use rotoclasts, we don't use any machines. Because if you use that, the fragments, they break down and the results you get is manipulated. So you do it manually, you do it for 10 minutes, and then you make different size fractions, you weigh them and you get a graph. Now, the most striking feature to classify between fall, flow and surges is the fall, the curve of the fall or the frequency diagram of the fall will show higher concentration of bigger size fragments. So your curve will be towards left hand side. When it is a flow, your curve will be in middle, like here. And when there is a surge, your curve should be on the extreme right hand side. Okay. So these are like the laboratory analysis that you have to perform in order to confirm that the observation you made on the field, that this is a flow, this is a fall, or this is a surge, is true or not. So once you get this, you have to determine the two parameters, which is sigma phi and mean diameter phi. Once you get these parameters, You can use a diagram proposed or a model proposed by Walker, where you can easily classify between a flow, surge, and fall. So these are the parameters, or these are the methods or analysis we use to determine between different types of pyroclastic deposits. Once you determine what kind of pyroclastic deposit it was, you perform componentry analysis. Why you need to know the componentry analysis? What are the components? These pyroclastic deposits are made of different components. It's like, let me use a Hindi word, bhel. It's like bhel. Bhel is used, or it is made up of various components. So it has kurmura, it has save, it has onions, it has tomatoes and everything. So it is the same with the pyroclastic deposits. It has various components. And if you add more chili, then your bhel become more spicy. Same here. If you add more magma, your pyroclastic deposit will be more magmatic. So what are the components? First is juveniles. These are like small bombs that come onto the surface. Then you have lithics. When I say lithics, these are the materials that get fragmented when there is an interaction between water and magma. So this also gives you an idea about what kind of lithology exists below the volcano. So therefore, these kind of volcanoes or monogenetic volcanoes are often considered as windows into the subsurface lithology. Now here you can see that there are different types of lithics. You can see that there are like volcanic breccias. You can have cemented volcano sedimentary cemented deposits. You can have rhyolites, okay? These kind of lithics, often they occur in form of impact sites, okay? Apart from that, you also get accretionary lapilli, which looks like peas. These accretionary lapillis also you find especially in surge deposit, because when there is humid conditions during this eruption, you get accretionary lapilli. What is accretionary lapilli? These are actually aggregates of ash particles. And when you find this accretionary lapilli in surge deposit, it indicates that the eruption occurred in a humid environment. So I'm coming slowly to the part of environment. Then often you also find some tree cast. For example, during the eruption, there was the region, there was a lot of forest, or there was a lot of vegetation. All this vegetation gets trapped during the eruption, and what they leave behind are tree cast. And when you find one of these, we can try to interpret the environment conditions. Paleo channels. Here you can see that there are two episodes of eruptions. For example, here you can see that this is a tephra package, and above this, there is another tephra package. But between the two, there is a erosional surface. So these are paleo channels. These are also like an indication about the paleo environment conditions. Apart from that, the most prominent or the most promising indicator is the paleosols. Here you can see in this figure, you have paleosols over here. Then you have the surges, you have the fall deposits, and again you have some surges. Okay. So how we can use these volcanoes to determine the paleo environment condition? Let me explain you this with an example. This is one of the volcano which I had investigated during my postdoc. Still I have to publish this because actually there is very little time, but yeah. So let me explain you about this volcano, how this volcano came into formation, how we determine the paleo environment condition, and how this volcano played a very important role in changing a local environment condition when it formed. So let me give an example of Alberca de los Espinos. In Spanish, Alberca is a pool, like a swimming pool. De los Espinos, Espinos is like thorns. This is because the volcano has a lot of vegetation, thorny vegetation, and the volcano has a pool inside, like a crater inside. That's why they call them as Alberca de los Espinos. Where is this volcano located? It is located in the Michoacán, Guanajuato volcanic field. The photo which I showed you a few minutes back, Now, within this volcanic field, you can see this volcanic field is located in the central part of Mexico. Here is Mexico. And here you can see that there is a belt of volcanoes. These belt of volcanoes, it is formed due to the subduction of the Pacific plate below the North American plate. Now, let me explain you. The Pacific plate actually divides into two, Rivera and Cocos. Why do we have this volcanoes? It is because of subduction. I hope you know what is subduction. So when the Rivera plates goes below the North American plates, you get different type of stratovolcanoes over here. And much south or much southeast, you can see that when the Cocos plate that goes below the North American plate, you get different types of volcanoes over here. Now, the angularity of this belt is because the different angle of subduction. For example, Rivera plate has a higher angle of subduction, whereas Cocos plate has a very more or less horizontal angle of subduction. That's why we get this angularity. Because in general, whenever there is a subduction, you have a parallel chain of volcanoes along the trench. But such is not the case with Mexico. Since there are two different plates that are subducting at different angle of subduction, we have an angle to the parallel chain of volcanoes or to the belt of volcanoes. Now, Michoacán-Guanajuato volcanic field is a part of subduction or is a product of subduction. You can see it almost covers major part of the central Mexico, and it covers an area of somewhere around 40,000 square kilometers. So here you can see how this is a digital elevation model image of Michoacán-Guanajuato volcanic field. I won't go into detail explaining what is each symbol. You can read below here. I'll show you the location of the volcano which I'm going to describe. Here is Alberca de los Espinos. It is situated on the margin of a paleo lake, which is Zacapo. Now, let me explain you why I call this as a paleo lake, because I'm not sure about whether you know about the history of Mexico, but it was colonized by Spain. So when the Spanish people arrived, they like it happened in India, they tried to commercialize things. So what they did was, in order to gain more area for cultivation or for agriculture, they drained the natural lake which was available. So all the water in this lake was drained somewhere around 1912 or somewhere around, 1912. No, somewhere around the end of the 19th century. So before 19th century, this lake was actually full, and there was like aquatic animals. Then there was fishes. There were different foraminers, and there was a well flourished aquatic system. But when the water was drained, well, now the area is used for cultivation. And this volcano, which formed on the margin of the Zacapo Lake, it formed during the late Pleistocene times. So you can imagine the environment condition that the volcano formed on the margin of a lake which had ample external water supply. So when the magma is coming onto the surface, it doesn't have to look for water. It was there. Okay. Now let me explain you. So what we did, we went to the field. We took samples from the surrounding volcanoes. We took samples from the Alberca de los Espinos. Okay, here are the sample positions. And we tried to date the samples. Once we dated the samples, we found the age of this volcano to be somewhere around 27,000 years ago. Okay, how does it look on field? Here you can see, here is the volcano Alberca de los Espinos. Here, this part is actually the lake part or the lake of Zacapo. Here is another picture of Alberca de los Espinos. I call it Alberca because it has a lake within, and the vegetation around this volcano has a lot of thorns. That's why they call them as Alberca de los Espinos. Here you can see that this is all Paleolithic basin. Okay. What are the deposits that are found in this volcano? It was very interesting because in this volcano, we found everything. We found pyroclastic faults, we found flows, we found surges, we found different lithics. And you can see how beautiful it looks, the deposits. So what we tried to do, we tried to give a type to each deposit. Also interesting was found was the juvenile fragments or the juvenile magma were actually coated in mud. So you can imagine the environment that there was magmatic activity, there was phreatomagmatic activity, there were mud pools, there were fragmentation of the magma, there was ample agua or ample water available for this eruption. So we went onto the field, we made the stratigraphic observation, we took the samples, we did lab analysis. As I said, we found or we classified them as faults, flows, and surges. We did the componentry analysis. We found how many were juveniles, how many were altered lithics, how many were mud-coated juveniles, etc. We did petrography of the juveniles. We found different types of, see whether there was different types of magma. We did geochemistry. Here you can see general geochemistry, basic geochemistry. And then we tried to determine the paleo environment condition. Now, when we start using this material to determine the paleo environment condition, we found that this volcano was formed on the paleo drainage channel of the lake. What I'm trying to say is, you can see here, here is a section, and this is the profile section of the volcano. And you can see here, the Sakapu Lake is over this side. And this region actually was the drainage or the outlet of the basin. But since this volcano formed in exactly on the drainage, on the pathway of the drainage or on the outlet, it kind of blocked the basin of Sakapu. And how do we confirm this? We confirm this by creating a paleotopography. Now, since we know what kind of deposits formed at what, like different tephra sequences, using ArcGIS, we tried to remove the material that was found and we tried to create a paleotopography. So when we form a paleotopography, we could see that the river Angulo, which dominates in this region, actually used to drain into the Sakapu Basin. But since this volcano came into formation, it kind of blocked the access to Sakapu Basin. And Sakapu Basin now became like a closed basin. So what happened? The water level within the Sakapu Basin rose. Okay. Why? Because the basin was also fed by local springs. Okay. So the local springs rose the level of the water in the Sakapu Basin, and this caused a fluctuation in the kind of sediments and microfossils that existed within the Sakapu Basin. And how do we know that? We compared the eruption or the episode of eruption with the paleo environmental data that was generated through pollens. Now, what was done was there is a group of paleontologists in UNAM, and they sampled the core somewhere around 50 meters, and they were able to date, or they were able to determine the paleoclimate conditions up to 50,000 years ago. Now, our eruption, the eruption of Alberca de los Espinos, is somewhere around 29,000 years ago. And what they found was the paleontologists were not able to explain a hiatus. Now, there was a hiatus in the sediments. There was no deposition. And they were not able to find a reason for this kind of hiatus. So when we dated the volcanoes and when we studied the deposit, we came to know that this volcano actually formed in an environment where there was a lot of water. And obviously this water came from the lake as well as from Rio Angulo. And when this volcano came into formation, it kind of cut the access of Rio Angulo to Sakapu Basin. So there was no more deposition from Rio Angulo into the Sakapu Basin, which explains the hiatus over here. So we try to conclude that due to the formation of this volcano, the local environment condition of the Sakapu Basin was changed completely. Okay, so you can see that even a small volcano of a small volume may have a greater effect on the local environment conditions. Now, it is important to study these kind of patterns because Mexico, or rather central part of Mexico, is full of such kind of volcanoes. And there are a lot of urbanization now, and there are people who are staying besides these volcanoes. And since it is an active volcanic field, anytime we might get an eruption that may cause a change in a local environment, or may cause an economic damage. So it is very important to keep on studying this type of volcanoes and try to see whether there is a tendency or a pattern or a frequency for their formation. And if there is a frequency or a pattern, then we need to know that where the next eruption would be. Apart from the paleo environment aspect, these volcanoes are very important because of the famous eruption of Paricutín, which took place in 1943. Here actually there was a cornfield, and within the cornfield abruptly there was a formation of a fissure, and suddenly within weeks there was a formation of a scoria cone. You can see here some old pictures of Paricutín, which is actually a volcano, the most active volcano in Michoacán, Guanajuato volcanic field. And this volcano, when it began its eruption, it lasted for somewhere around 10 years, the eruption. It is a monogenetic volcano because currently when we made some investigation, we did not find any magma chamber. So the volcano is dead now, but it was the most recent volcano that was formed within the volcanic field. You can see some pictures, old photos. Here is the town of Angahuan, the old town. Here are some people. Dr. Attle was the first geologist who came and studied these volcanoes and took some pictures. You can see now the photo which we saw before. The church is now below lava flow. This is how it looks today. And the older town of Angahuan now have been moved further south. Now they had already relocated the town of Angahuan. So I would like to emphasize that although these volcanoes are small, they are complex, they are hazardous, and they are actually a great tool to understand the paleo environment conditions. With this, I would like to conclude my talk and open for questions. Thank you.
That's a great presentation, Pooja. Anyone has any question, they can type in the chat box, and then I can read the questions, and then Pooja will be able to answer it. I guess Pooja can also see the chat box.
Yes, I'm looking at it. There are so many questions. I am not sure which one should I.
Yeah, we will go through few questions. Rest, like, they can mail you if they have any important queries they have and we missed it.
Sure. I can see that someone is asking about Yellowstone. For that, we have to do another talk, I guess. It's a complete different system. It's a super volcano. It's an extreme version of volcanoes. And
there was a question regarding how we can use remote sensing for this particular study?
Okay, more than remote sensing, what? With the advent of the technology, actually, we are applying now drones. We are using drones to get beautiful images of volcanoes, and so that we can make better maps. For example, for Parikutin, initially it was very difficult to differentiate between different lava flows and the deposits, but now through drones we can do that very well. And remote sensing is good for basically for making maps and for making sections. I would also suggest that remote sensing has a very important role out these days for studying volcanoes, because now it becomes easy to access to see the eruptions and to see this kind of formation of a dome or the activity of a volcano through drones. And you have like videos, you have images, and you can compare the images and you can make very good estimation of volumes, like incremented volume or any dilation in a volcano. Or for example, since these kind of volcanoes are often governed by tectonic configuration like faults, which are still active. So if there is any debris or if there is any morphological deformation that takes place in a volcano, so it is of excellent use. I would say that here now we are using more of drones technology and using different programs to make maps and to make like profiles and everything, then like Landsat image or something like that. I also saw another question.
Thank you for the seminar.
Welcome. Okay, I saw a question which says, what is the difference between polygenetic and bimodal volcanism? Bimodal volcanism, this terminology we use for petrogenesis, when you have two different types of magmas, rhyolites and basaltic magmas. Now these rhyolites and basaltic magmas may come from same magma chamber or may come from different magma chamber. When I say polygenetic magma, I'm talking about the style of eruption. For example, when I say polygenetic, it can have both rhyolitic or basaltic magma, but there are multiple eruptions. I'm talking about the episodes, not about the petrogenesis. So bimodal, the terminology we use for petrogenesis, and polygenetic we use for the morphology or for the amount or the number of episodes of eruptions. Did hotspots move? Yes, they do move, but very little. They do move because when you try to, and their movement is relative to the North Pole or to the poles. Okay, so since the pole fluctuates as well, and so we can say that yes, so hotspots also move.
Participants, please mute yourself. You have any way, you can type in the chat box. Okay, there's another question. How much difference is in the mineralogically of monogenetic and polygenetic genetic types of volcanoes?
Okay, like in the initial slides where I showed you that there could be different types of monogenetic volcanoes. When you have polymagmatic monogenetic volcanoes, then you can see that yes, the mineralogy differs. And in polygenetic volcanoes, as I said, there are different magma chambers and there are different types of magma involved. Then of course you find a lot of different types of minerals. So in case of monogenetic, to simplify, only when a monogenetic volcano is polymagmatic, it may have different type of minerals.
There's one more question. Is it true that even today, new igneous rocks have a possibility of formation from the lava?
I didn't get that question.
Okay. I will repeat the question. Is it true that even today, new rocks
possibility of automation allow?
I couldn't hear you correctly, like clearly. Your voice was breaking, Deepak.
Okay. Is it true that even today, new igneous rocks have a possibility of formation from the lava?
Okay, again, your voice broke, but let me look for this question. Is it true? What do you mean by new igneous rocks? I mean, whoever who asked this question, igneous rocks are actually formed every now and then whenever you have an eruption. So I actually didn't get your question. So whenever there is an eruption, you will have igneous rock or igneous deposit or pyroclastic deposits.
Okay, there's one more question. Yellowstone will be very helpful. Hopefully you will teach us about it as, okay. This is just a message.
Mm-hmm. I can see another one by Kirti Gupta. Tuff is classified as an igneous rock, but it is formed by the process of compaction and cementation. So won't that make a sedimentary rock? Okay, this is a very good question because often people get confused with the terminology. When you're talking about sedimentary rock, we use the terminology like compaction and especially cementation. But when you're talking about tuff or ignimbrites, you talk about welding. So when you say tuff can be highly welded or it can be loosely welded. So when it is loosely welded, it forms like a loose deposit. Okay. But when the tuff are highly welded, it forms ignimbrites, which actually looks like a rock. And it is often identified by eutectics textures and Fiamme textures, something like that. We don't use the word cementation for tuff. We use welding.
Okay, the next is there any difference between monogenetic and extinct volcano? In field, how can we differentiate?
Okay. You can call a monogenetic volcano, well, these are again like terminology used. For example, if you have a monogenetic volcano, which is in formation, it is active. The monogenetic volcano, yeah, like it has formed, but still it is like a bit active, like in case of Parikutin. We are not sure whether still Parikutin is monogenetic because it might have eruption. So that's why we did this analysis. Like we made geophysical survey and we found that we tried to look for magma chambers, but there are no magma chambers active currently. So we can call Parikutin as a monogenetic extinct volcano because now it won't have eruption. So yes, it's like a terminology.
Okay, there's one more interesting question. Is there a standard method for estimation the current rate of magma production at a volcanic site?
Yes. Magma production. What we can do is actually we can just calculate the volume of magma that is coming out of a volcano. And for that, we can use infrared cameras, you can use drones, you can use, you can also use this spectrometers, and you can combine all this data and you can actually calculate the volume of magma that is coming out of a volcano. And of course, if you have a database, like on daily basis, then you can actually calculate the rate at which the magma is produced.
Okay. So we'll take this last question because there are so many messages which is popping up. Do monogenetic volcanoes have fixed composition throughout its episode? or does it change over the course of the eruption?
Okay, again, I would like to take you back to the same, to the slide. Can I put the slide? That would be better.
Yes.
Okay, here we go. So here on the left hand side, you can see that there are different types of monogenetic volcanoes. Now these monogenetic volcanoes can be in the form of clusters, and these clusters are formed because they have different conduits. Now, if these conduits are connected to different magma chamber, yes, this monogenetic volcanoes may have different composition. But if you have a single monogenetic volcano with a single conduit and a single magma chamber, you won't have any change in the composition. But again, if you have a monogenetic volcano, which is polymagmatic, where you have different conduits, which is connected to different magma chamber, is forming one solo structure, like one structure, one volcano, then yes, in this case, you will find magmas of different composition.
Okay. I guess like the participants, we will be mailing you the feedback form along with that. We'll also share the email. The further like queries you can moving to the last a vote of thanks.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, Deepak sir. Hi Pooja, that was a crossing lecture. It was really amazing listening to you.
Thank you.
You've introduced us to a very unique volcanic feature, monogenetic volcanoes, something a lot of us did not know about. And sitting here on the Deccan Volcanics, I'm very sure that we have budding geologists who are listening to you right now. They'll be planning the field trip any moment. Just let the lockdown get over and I think they'll be running out.
Oh, yes.
So it was a lot of fun learning about these with some excellent pictures and videos. And of course, all the yummy metaphorical examples that you were giving us. So thank you so much for taking the time to share your work with us.
Thank you.
Apart from that, I would like to thank the organizing members who have helped us in setting up this event. And of course, thank you participants for showing your interest in this series of lectures. I would like to remind you all that we have another lecture tomorrow at 5:30 p.m. by Dr. Andre Droxler. Now, Dr. Droxler is from Rice University, Houston, and he'll be telling us more about the origin of atolls. He has also requested that all the participants please read a paper that he'll be talking about. The link is already there on the poster that was shared with you. So make sure you do your homework, because I'm very sure Sir will be asking us about it during the lecture. And do put a reminder for the lecture on your calendars. Thank you everyone for being with us today. Thanks again, Pooja. And
thanks, Nina.
Have a nice evening.